It's going to be hard to hear and hard to see. And if you knock a fly out of your...
Okay. Here's one over there, $2.50, Bob.
Okay, $2.50. Do I hear $3? Sorry, it's a beautiful Mexican clock. Okay.
You got enough ass, Bob? Pocket? Where are you?
I got it in the pocket.
Okay. No, really, especially Stewart, when they asked me to do this, no one wanted to do it but me. No. I'm the oldest, and that's you. I wrote it all down. Wait, is that it?
No,
I don't. You
don't
have it?
I do.
How can you write something down about your mother? What do you know? Well, I just want to take this opportunity, though, to just say how great the people have put this together. I gotta say that. I'm really special. Before they have departed the other side. Stupid to be true. I mean, where else can you ever receive an opportunity to speak without interruption? Well, I'm a professional salesman, and I earn my living by speaking and controlling conversation, but when I visit Mother, I can't get a word in English. This reminds me, I asked my mother and Lulu and Owen, one of their big things is going out to breakfast. I think they go out to breakfast for lunch and dinner. They love to do this. You know, I went out with them a few times and I said, Owen, how do you ever get a word in? He says, I got it all night, man. Oh, yeah, I got this whistle and I blow it. So now at last, the truth can be told. She's a capybara. Most of my brothers and my sisters are not here yet, but they know I have a favorite a saying I have, for I call her Mother Lode. So I decided to look up the definition of the two words. Mother, according to Webster's, is a maternal female parent who provides tenderness and affection and support. Lode, is described as a rich find, an abundant store. So very, very interesting, isn't it? Things we all take for granted from mothers. All these loving ingredients, all good mothers have some of these qualities. Well, I consider myself one of the lucky offsprings because my mother, a great mother, has all these traits and more. I know because she's demonstrated these qualities all my life. She's been the rock of Gibraltar to me and my family. I think this stability and love she has expressed in these are the qualities of the stability and love she's expressed. These are the outstanding traits of how I love about my mother. The quiet, unassuming woman that she is, she would never admit any problems. You say quiet? My mother quiet? No. Why, she's always talking. Well, she has a lot to say, and she's never dull. In closing, I would just like to say again what an honor it is for me to be able to pay tribute to Mom. And finally, my mother is truly a rich find, an abundant store, a loving, tender, giving rock of Gibraltar, indeed a splendid mother love.
First of all, I'd like to say in a word of gratitude regarding all the children, grandparents of this family, that, and I know I can know, you know, how little eyes have been watching them at all the family gatherings and all, but it's been rich, very rich, to have the family gatherings, associate, and receive the good things from the aunts and uncles and so on. I really have appreciated those things. My mother, Millicent Stewart, was born as the sixth child on the 28th of June, 1908. She's often told us about her childhood, which involved a lot of fun times, but a lot of hard work. She has told us how she used to thin beets and things on the farm, and I never had cause to doubt that because she's been a hard worker. And I know all the things that I'll tell you about her. You already know if you know her, because she displays them in her everyday life. But my mother, on the one hand, provided a great blessing for us, and maybe it turned out not too good in the long run. She is a super gourmet cook. Those of you who have... You know, they tell how Beethoven or Mozart or some of those could go to a concert and listen to it and then go home and write out the whole score. And my mother's that way when it comes to cooking. She could go to a fine gourmet dish and she'd go home and make it. The reason that that hasn't turned out too well for some of us in the line.
He refused to take her. He said she came home in tears. He just said, don't come to me. You don't do what I tell you anyway. But those last five children were all born under.
Thank you.
slide after one, and we were standing close to one, and we go on the water slide after. Because the other kids were all...
Yeah. uncle. Hello. Well.
Thank you.
right, we're on.
Okay, go. First guy to half court back. Down low, down the middle.
down the first time. Wait. Left hand, really low to the ground, and keep your head up. Go ahead. Head up.
Come on, man.
this feeling real quick. Going up there to listen, what do you think of our little thing? Our little reunion.
Think of our little thing.
He said that socks, at least on the embedded floor, she refused to pick them up, take them into the laundry room. He also refused to pick them up. Each day he would put on a new, a clean shirt, shorts and socks. Each day he left them at the same spot. They piled up until he ran out of shirts and socks. He went and bought some more. Until there were 27 shirts, pairs of socks, and shorts. Well, finally it reached the boiling point. And they weren't going to say anything about it. They were stewing underneath, but they never said anything about it. Finally he says, what goes here? Why aren't you taking care of this? She said, if you think I'm going to be a slave to you and take care of your dirty clothes, you're crazy. Well, they just, they went out of tooth and told me. He was expecting her to change. She was expecting him to change. They went to see the marriage counselor. How would you think that they could resolve a problem like that?
Work. She didn't mind washing his clothes, did she?
Oh, she didn't mind washing him, so she resented picking them up.
Yeah, well, that's, so I think that really, if they had talked it over, she would have been glad to wash his clothes. He'd have been glad to put them in the dirty clothes.
But he wasn't glad to put him in the dirty clothes.
So I feel like it's his fault.
She should have been glad to pick up after
us. You see, when you have those kinds of expectations, it's hard to resolve them because the one feels that they're being put down by the other, being in control. You see? Well, they resolved that problem by bringing a clothes hamper into the bedroom. So he put him in the clothes hamper, then she didn't feel that she was being put upon to take him. Or he said that he was working on his doctor's degree, and his wife was teaching high school at this point. And this one day she came home and said, I've been asked to be on the senior prom committee that teacher super advisor committee. And she said, would you be interested in going to the prom when it comes? He says, that sounds like a great idea. You bet. I'll mark it down. She tells him the date. He says, I'll be ready to go. It was 2 months away, so he had plenty of time. Well, as the time approached, it got to be within a month, and she says, you haven't forgot about the prom, have you? No, I'll be ready to go. You bet, I remember. 2 weeks, she thought about the prom, yeah. Got it on my calendar, I'll be ready to go. Well, the day came, Saturday, it was on Saturday. He says, usually on Saturday, I would help her around the house, vacuum and do a lot of things like that, help catch things up. So I went through the normal routine, as I usually do. Noticed the time. Time to get ready for the prom, so I got all ready to go. Well, he says, we got out in the car, and as we drove to the prom, she didn't say one word. She was stone silent all the way to the dance. They got to the dance, she wouldn't speak to him all through. If they were standing there and another couple would come up, why, she just opened up, chat. You know, everything's just fine. They leave. Stone silent, you know. Well, finally, they went home from the dance, and he says, all right, what have I done? What have I done?
No flowers.
Mom.
She says, maybe you didn't notice that everybody else there had a course on, and that they went out to dinner before the dance. Is that all? A corsage? Why didn't you tell me? I'd have gone and got you 50 of them. What was her response to that?
If I have to tell you, it doesn't mean it.
But you see, whose problem is her problem? She had expectations that he wasn't aware of, right? The only way that they could fulfill those expectations was for her to let him know, or him to somehow bring it about.
So she was wrong in not the...
No, but could she have solved her problem without his getting the flowers? Did he have to get the flowers?
There's not 88 points. They scored 88 points on this. Show you how mad he was. He got three technicals. He blamed at us and the officials. They threw him out of the game. And after the game, he made us feel about this big. And we blew him by 50 points. And he's still just a couple of days. Anyway, Coach went on and played better, played harder. I was starting all the time at this point. One game, we had a practice game against a Canadian team. In defense, Coach Knight's big on denying the passing lanes. So if the guys over there got the ball, my man's here, my man's trying to get the ball, so deny him the pass, so Knight gets the ball. I guess I was a little asleep. I fought him quite good enough. I didn't deny the lane. I just did not deny one pass. He didn't score on me. I just didn't deny a pass. Called timeout, ran out of the court, grabbed me, threw me down the bench. I didn't start from there on out because of that. And same with a lot of other players. He just took him right out and set him right on the bench. He told me that there was, in Puerto Rico, it's so humid, they have five or six people around the court with mops, just for every time you go down the court, they're out there for humidity. He went up to me, took me and told me right next to some old mop woman and said, that mop, you couldn't even hold her mop. I mean, brains, you can't even hold that old lady's mop. Anyway, from then on out, I was denying the passing. But you know, that's the type of coach he is. He's perfectionist. That's so, as it happened, then a couple of days later, Isaiah Thomas, the star guard, was on the team. And Isaiah was having a bad practice. Coach Knight threw him out of the gym, threw him out of practice. Coach Knight was so upset that about 5 minutes later, the team came in the gym. We were supposed to have the gym for an hour. Team came in the gym before our time was up. They were over in the corner bouncing balls. It's a Brazilian team. He yelled at them. They couldn't understand him. So we went over there and just started hollering at the coach. All of a sudden, the policeman came in. The policeman said, they stay here because I let them in. Coach Knight, and they were arguing back and forth. Anyway, the officer was talking like this. He says, I have authority here. Anyway, he ended up poking Coach Knight in the eye. Coach Knight didn't take any crap. He just wound up, smacked the guy. It wasn't a fist. He just wound up. Powdered him right across the face with open hand. Well, needless to say, that was it. Officer chased him around the gym, finally got him, handcuffed him, hauled him out of practice. So there we were in practice, you know, just watching the whole thing where the coach has gone to jail. But anyway, that was probably the best thing that could happen to us, because we had about had enough of Coach Knight. Anyway, he couldn't do much discipline in our jail, so we relaxed. Played pretty basketball, and they let him out for final. You know, he was only in there for a day, but you know, he was losing the papers.
Yeah.
It was a big thing. It wasn't the
Did he ever go back down on their indictment?
No. No.
Never go.
He stayed here.
If he goes to Puerto Rico, he will be arrested in Gainesville. Mm-hmm.
I don't believe in that kind of coaching myself. I don't know what your comment is on.
Everything possible for that family. And I was shocked because I thought, geez, how can this woman take him? But he was the nicest husband around her, around his kids. Fantastic. His kids don't play ball. His kids are kind of fat and out of shape. It's really kind of surprising, but he's a great dad and a great husband, I guess. But when he gets on the court, on the floor, it's different.
Danny, let's say something about the team vote you had. You and Rocco.
Yeah. Anyway, with the incident with Coach Knight, being the papers and everything, during that time, I guess the Puerto Rican people were upset in the United States, and then the Coach Knight thing just kind of made it worse. But anyway, there were a lot of threats on Coach Knight's life and on our teams, I guess. So when Coach Knight got out of jail, he came back and said, guys, we're leaving. We're not staying here, we gotta leave. I don't think we're safe here. So, he says, I can't force you to go. He says, we're gonna have a team vote. So my opinion is we should leave. I'm afraid someone's gonna be hurt. We voted to stay. Team vote. won by a couple votes in the region state of Puerto Rico. As it turned out, the final game against the Puerto Rican national team in the middle of Kamehameha Stadium, about 10,000 screaming Puerto Ricans, I'll tell you. That makes Mexico's pit playground or something. It was something scary. And that was Coach Snyder worried about, was something would happen, fans would attack us or whatever. Security was something else. My parents were down there, have army guards down there with their army outfits and boots and guns on, get the whole works. So it was a different atmosphere. As it turned out, we ended up winning the championship, and we held Coach Knight up on our shoulders. And he just went around, and looked like he was pointing at every Puerto Rican in the audience. Just, you know, wanted to show them the United States is number one. He has no love for the people down there at all. He has no love for them.
He's lucky he wasn't really, you know.
He's lucky he didn't get hurt.
Yeah.
He does have a military background.
Well, yeah, he coached Knight, coached at West Point, he was in the Army for a while. So he's, that's kind of, I guess, the way his pattern is coaching.
What
do you
hate to get along
with?
Yeah.
State boys.
We need a
brochure
to make it a real football.
Typhoid fever in Salt Lake City that summer, and he thought he was going to die, and he had his fortune told, and the fortune teller told him that he would die when he had five children. That was long before he was married, when he had the fortune told. And at that time he had just five children. He thought, my gracious, what would my wife do with five children living in Salt Lake? She never could make a living. So he decided to move us down to Benjamin, and then we went to Benjamin. But before we went, Mother got the typhoid fever, and while she was in the hospital, she gave birth to a child, her third son, Howard. And of course, he died of malnutrition because he had to be taken away from Mother, and at that time, doctors didn't know how to feed children without the mother's help. Well. So we moved, but we had those two, Mother and Father, both had typhoid fever in Salt Lake City, and we thought it was due to some carrier who lived within the neighborhood. But we moved down to Benjamin, and in less than 21 days, I came down with typhoid fever, and that's when the spider saved my life. I should have told you the spider on it until you got to it, but then we will have
it. Healed for the night, brother.
Oh, I'm not used to these vehicles. Well, we went to up to Benjamin for the celebration of the 24th of July, and I got extremely sick during the day and just laid around all day in the shade and burning up with fever, and we went home, and Mother said, well, we'll have to call the doctor. They called the doctor from Pace, Dr. Winters, and he came down and he said, well, I think he's got typhoid fever because he found out Mother had had it and Father had both had it, and he said it's been less than 21 days, and that was the incubation period. So I came down, he said that's evidently what he's got. Well, so I got sicker and sicker, and one time Mother said, now, at that time they starved you to death. If the disease didn't kill you, they starved you to death. And I was on the starvation diet for this during the development of the disease, and I know Mother had to leave town or leave the farm one day, and she said the neighbors across there, they had typhoid fever, and the doctor told them they could not eat, and they were immigrants who had come over from Germany a few months before, but they fed, when the doctor wasn't around, they fed their son a good heavy meal after he'd been starving for about 3 weeks, and it killed him. So Mother said, now, when I go, don't you... You know, she asked that woman to come over and take care of me during the time she had gone to town, and she said, now, I want you to... At this time, I was 7 years old. Wait a minute. Yes, I was 7 years old. So she said, promise me that you won't take one bit of food from that woman because she killed her own son and I don't want her to kill you. So I said, oh, I won't eat anything. And I wasn't hungry anyway. Yeah, I'd only been going then about 4 weeks without food. Well, while I was living in the front room, isolated from the rest of the family. They knew that the others might get it if I was not segregated from the rest of the family. So while I was lying there waiting for time to pass, Pearl fell down. She came down with a typhoid fever, but she had a light case of it. Type that we called at that time walking typhoid. You could still walk with it. By this time, I couldn't even move in bed. I was just lying there waiting for the end to come in. But at any rate, the doctor, every time he'd come, which was about once a week, he'd look at me and he'd say, this boy cannot live. And Mother would say, oh, yes, he can. He must live. He's going to live. And the next time he'd come, I remember, he'd say this same story to Mother, or this statement. I paid no attention to it because I didn't even know what dying was. But finally, well, I think I'd had it about these three or four weeks when Pearl came down with it, and she was only down with it, I think, about 3 weeks. But during the process, during the time she was, well, I was on a large bed in the front parlor. That was a northeast room in the home at the ranch. And they put in a couch there in the southwest corner of this room for her to sleep on. And it was one of these sanitary couches that when you got over on the edge of it, the weight, where there were no legs under, only in the center, so it would tip up with your weight. Well, while we were lying there during the day, there was a fancy pattern of wallpaper on the walls and ceiling, and it was very intricate figures on it, and it would take hours to trace one set of these figures to the floor, and I was tracing these figures, and I finally saw a spider way up in the top of along the corner and of the ceiling and the wall, and it very slowly started moving down, and it kept moving down, and then finally Pearl saw this spider, and she had an obsession against spiders, and she got more frightened, and she went over in the middle of the bed, and she kept moving over towards my bed, getting further away from where the spider appeared to be coming down, and oh, I don't know, it took an hour, I guess, to get down there, but finally when the spider got down to the bed, she was riding right on the outside rail, and finally all of a sudden, down went the bed, she tipped up and threw her right out in the room. Well, I saw this happen, but Pearl had the walking typhoid, and she started meandering around on the floor just like a drunkard. And I tried to call Mother, but I was laughing. I was laughing, so... Forget all. I was laughing. I started laughing. Now, the laughter was primarily just a little... action of my diaphragm. That's about all the strength I had, but at least it was causing me so much emotion that I couldn't call Mother. So this went on for about an hour or so, and she'd fall over against my bed and then go all around the room falling. But during this hour, my digestive system was being agitated greatly, and finally, I got so I made a little gurgling noise loud enough that Mother could hear in the other room. She came in and put Pearl back in bed and got rid of the spider. Well, that by this time, I was probably on the way out. And so then everything was all over. But the next day, the people who lived at the ranch, who was primarily Pat and Alan, Stewart and Otto and the rest of the kids, they came to the window. They'd always talk to me through the window. And they heard about the spider and all the fun I had got out of this. So they said, would you mind telling us about the spider or what happened? And so I tried to tell them this story all over again as took me about 4 hours to tell them the story. I'll try to finish this in a little less time than that. And so I started laughing again. And I laughed, I think, for about 3 hours. I could not get that story out. And so during this process of all this action, the therapeutic value of it was that I started my digestive system to working. And the doctor said, well, one of the reasons he won't live is because he hasn't had and won't have any action in his digestive system. But it was only about another day that I had a tremendous bowel movement, and from then on I started getting well. The doctor was the spider, and he gave me the therapy that I needed to start my digestive system that had completely given up and quit with action again, and it was only about 3 more weeks till I could start taking food, and here I am.
Thank you, Hal. One more award before we have the Lulu's family give their skit. This award is for the loudest mouth. any questions? I mean, Walt? Family would like to come up and introduce what they have. We'll turn the time over to them now.
Friends and neighbors are not germane to this case. could check with, see where they are. Maybe there was Roy Dory in Germany.
They don't go to Germany for breakfast, honey.
Well, Pearl's driving, they might make it. Okay, let's find out if Jerry knows where they might be.
Yeah?
Do you know where Grandpa and Grandma are?
Gee, I haven't seen them. Jesus. But I heard they're supposed to come over and help Rick build some cabinets. Let me ask him. He's in the house.
Hey, Rick!
Do you happen to know where my mother and dad are?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir.
Why do you say no, sir?
Well, I just got back from the base, and I still got that Marine Corps blood in me, sir.
What color is Marine Corps blood?
Green!
You don't know where they are, then, huh?
No, I just got through working down at the police department down at the base, and we didn't arrest him, and he didn't enlist, so he's not there.
Well, okay, we'll check and see if somebody else knows. Maybe it's Jody, though.
Right.
Oh, where's yours?
I'm glad we're all home finally, because I have my car. I just drove into town. Who wants to help me unpack? Don't worry, I only have one couch.
Where have you been?
At school for 3 years. Just think, this is the last year you'll have to do this. The last year.
Right. You have to know where your grandpa and grandma are.
I've been gone for 3 years. I don't know.
You mean they were right?
I've heard you've been remodeling the house. Now, this is interesting. It always changes each time I come home. Yeah.
They weren't up there with you, huh?
Nope, weren't with me.
All right, let's see. None of us know where they are. So they aren't in Germany, they aren't with us. You sure you tried every place you can think of?
Yeah.
Okay, maybe my brother John and his wife Joanne know where they are. So why don't you go over and talk to them and see if they know where they are?
We're gonna go and do some little dance.
Collar and curl.
Well, Joe, have to check those two places. If they're not there, check mine with my sister Candy and Jack out of Gamma Linda.
Yep. I'm sorry.
Come up and get next award goes to the biggest wave maker. We're talking about the slide that we came down the slide today and came out. You're right, Mary Judkins.
Time I go up the ladder, she keeps on saying, "Now be careful, boy, be careful. Don't hurt yourself, be careful." About the sixth time up, I turned around to this lady and said, "Lady, I am fat, but I'm not clumsy."
This next award, we're going to need a little audience participation on, goes to the biggest biceps. And we have three nominations to come up here and show off their biceps. Jay Judkins. Come on up on the stand, Jay. Really? These are biceps.
Mr. America, let's see.
Who was that? Oh, Stan Blood.
Many more years than we would really like to admit, but this goes back as near as we can recall to the 1940s. Walt and Garn and I guess Clark are in the service, and we're all worried about our men that are in the service, whether they'll get home okay. But anyway, this is the war years, and they weren't the bleakest of times, but we did have some fun. And we had a dear friend named Larry Kane. and he was a great track star, and he moved from our town to another town called Inglewood, California, and we missed him, and he missed us, I guess, and periodically we would go to Larry's house, and we're very, very young teenagers, so we don't drive. We can't drive yet. We don't have driver's license. But we would go to Larry's house, and he loved to go to the movie. Now, we would go up to Hollywood, where there's just one great big movie theater after another one, number one line movies, and he would go to take us to three or four movies, and after the third or fourth movie, on the very same day, you come out and your eyeballs, you know how they're like. But anyway, this is a story of one of those excursions, you might say. And it's summertime like now. We're out of school, summer vacation. We're about 12, 13, 14 years old. And we it's very important to this story that we tell you what we're wearing. Now, in those days, the kids in California, the teenagers, wore t-shirts and Levi's. And it's a very hot day. We can't drive, so we have to get on this bus. And that's the way we would go to Hollywood or L.A., wherever we're going to the show. All right, now we're on this bus, and there's the warrior, so you don't have nice plush cushions like this. You sit on steel seats. It's like flying mats in the Air Force, right, Uncle Walt? Okay, darn, you know about that. So we're not flying mats, but we're on this RTD bus, and there's metal seats. And it's a warm day, and naturally we're perspiring a little bit. And the bus driver pulls up to the stop sign. And I'm sitting next, this is the window here. This is where Karen's at. Karen's over at the stop sign. And he pulls up to the stop sign, and I got my arm out the window like this, and of course it's a real hot day, so they have all the windows down. And I got my arm out like this, and I'm amazed at how close he came to the stop sign. He could have taken up, and then Tom's going to tell you about the stop sign. For those of you that don't understand the way stop signs were back in the 40s. Well, we had what they call semaphore. You know what a semaphore is? Each sign holds it. They come down like this. Each semaphore is to go like this. That's a stop.
And you would say, stop or go.
It took a lot of current. I think they had 220 volts. This one wasn't working too good. Now, when it goes down, like it. That's stop. S-T-R.
That's the one we were on.
That's the one we were on.
Stop. And I kept remarking to myself. Now, Tom and Larry are talking, you see, and I'm looking at this sign, and I said to myself, I can touch that. We're so close, I can touch it. And that was one of the biggest mistakes I ever made in my whole life, because there was a direct short in that semaphore sign. But we don't know that. Now, these two guys don't know what I'm doing.
I don't think I know what I'm doing either.
I run away from the movie. So.
They're talking about the movie.
Shoot them up, Larry. Four movies in one day. Well, I'll never get over that.
Thanks a lot, Larry.
Okay, I reach out and grab the sign. And now I am now going to reach out the window, and I'm going to grab...
Now, it's pretty tough to get three pretty big teenage kids in these little two theaters, but we're in. All right, I reach out, and I touch the sign, and...
Karen, you want to hold the mic?
Hold the mic.
This is what happened.
Hi, Mike. There really is a need for this. Yeah, really, thanks a lot, Larry.
I love it.
Right,
okay.
Good.
You guys don't need
to hop. It really was just...
It really was a neat movie, Larry. I love it. It really was neat.
Okay, I'm reaching out for the sign now.
Grab the sign.
Get the sign.
Get the
Thank you.
Montgomery M. Hightelli.
What did you do?
Wait, my tongue.
I'm almost dead here.
I reached out and grabbed the sign.
What?
I grabbed the sign and hit my head short.
Fuck the head short. Yeah. Larry. Larry. You killed Larry.
I killed Larry.
What happened, Larry?
I killed Larry.
What did you do, Larry?
I hate you guys. Don't ever come back. From either one.
There is a prologue to this story. They don't remember this, but I do. Even though I am the oldest, I do remember. After you're probably wondering what the other passengers thought. So this bus driver gets back and he says, "I've had it with you guys. You're always clowning around." And this woman says, "You shouldn't do that. They're all epileptics."
Excited! Who's excited? These are my kind of people!
for the posterity.
This is a form of popcorn cabinet.
Everybody's ashamed of these now, but in the old country, they used to say the best everything went into that.
And during these family preparation nights, we feel it's really important that the married couples get together, learn a little bit about themselves, about their family, and about preparing themselves in order to raise that family. Every month, I was kind of delegated president of this meeting, and every month we set forth a packet. The reason I'm talking to you about this is because to me this is very important. Between husband and wife. What I had them do is I had them write down specific items that they felt that their spouse has really achieved from themselves, like being a good mother, a good housekeeper, or being a good provider, or being loving and caring and considerate. And from those, they were to pick one and to characterize it in their own character and become part of their own spouse. I just personally would like every one of you, because I can see how close this family is, to get together to improve the relationships that we have with one another and to become close, because this is an eternal family and we'll always have each other. And these packets, in case any of you are interested, if you want to follow some kind of outline, I'll just leave them up here. But each one of these families do something special. Karma. I guess, I don't know if any of you know Karma and Hal's place. It's all, they all cut their own wood every year, and their whole house is heated entirely on what they provide during that year. And that's really special. Another thing, she just slipped me a note, she said another thing, that if the room of their kids is clean on Friday night, they're able to sleep in the TV room. I think that's kind of special. And also, you know, birthdays can be really, really unique, because that's something special for them. The thing that I would really like to put forward is that families are so important. If you get these traditions running, you'll have such a close-knit family that'll last forever.
Biggest family, Al and Karma.
heads out while you're sitting up.
Humor, but he was not a wit. One needs to think fast to be a great wit, and Otto Wren never did anything fast.
Not true.
Once when he was deer hunting with his family, he was resting alone on the side of a mountain, peeling an egg, when he spied a deer. Millicent Colstrip Stewart was exactly the opposite from her husband. She did everything fast, and her quick and spontaneous and unpredictable wit made her famous. There are a few of her good ones.
Howell was driving Millie to Pace one day in their brand new livery straight six. Now, the Payson folk looked down on the Benjamin folk. They were uppity-class folk. In case they were hillbillies, they were people of low class. They came from a hick town. Now, it happened to be a Payson at that time had a big racial population of 732. Anyway, they were coming to town with a freshly painted sign sitting outside. And on this sign it read, "Drive slow and see our town. Drive fast and see our jail." And Millie said,
"It's about a toss-up."
Once when Millie was asked to speak in church, she walked up to the podium a little nervous and said,
"I don't know why I'm so scared of you. You can't hurt me as bad as I can hurt you."
Once when she was at Roselle visiting, Jill was telling about her new boyfriend. Her new boyfriend was Spanish, Jewish, and not a Mormon. And Millie said,
"Jill, marry your own kind. They're bad enough."
We're ready. Millie was extremely modest. If she ever saw a doll without clothes on, she would say, "If I ever see that doll again without any clothes on, it's going to disappear. When I was a girl, if I let my doll without any clothes on, I didn't see it for 6 months." Another time, however, Joan asked Grandma what she would, when they were in Las Vegas, what she would say to a topless waitress.
"I would just say I'd sing better."
One of their favorite pastimes at the old ranch was gathering around the piano and singing. Otto ran the greenback sheep music when he was out on one of his runs. He was a mail clerk. One time he found a song, a very famous song, written for a Broadway play entitled "Don't Bring Lulu." It was amazing because all five daughters were mentioned in the song. What were the daughters' names? Oh, here we have Pearl, Min, Rose, Nancy, Lulu, and these are not common names.
And now, if you blink twice, you will see those same sisters and brothers, except for Nancy Jean, singing the same song they sang 55 years ago at the old ranch. Will all those people please come up?
Thank you.
gift.
I gave it to him. I gave it to Lee.
pass the eggs.
Eat your mash.
What happened in the grain field?
We were shopping grain and each broken well, making three rows on each side.
The man brought a bundle from the fourth row and put it on the shop.
Please, please, please pass the eggs.
And then she took it off the shop and put it back where it was in.
Well, if anybody wants any eggs at this table, they'll have to reach for them. Don't reach for anything at this table.
Otto, did you hitch up old Ash to the buggy? We need to take that to the train.
Good. Pearl was riding up and down the road at 41st.
Oh, Shaw! I've only got a half an hour to catch the Orem and face it.
He's never missed a train yet, kids. But take him in the Liberty, Lulu.
I gotta go in here.
Thank you.
around for that always tips over on
them. He's done it before.
A couple of more awards here. We can have it quiet. This award goes to the person
who made the most money at the auction, who brought in the most money.
Bonnie Stewart. Had these little hand clippers. We had no electricity in those days, and
He was working these hand flippers, and gosh, he was pushing in awful hard. And Stewart says, "Grandpa, you're pushing in awful hard on the back of my neck." And Grandpa said, "Well, Stewart, you've got that hole back here, and I happen to push hard to cut the hair in it." "Yeah, Grandpa, but you're going to push it in farther." Little stories like this, I think we could tell for days and years about Father. Most of them would relate to either of his two peculiarities of being so slow and being so meticulous. Showed Walt dressing like that. By the time Dad dressed for a storm, the spring thaw was in. A few things I wanted to mention, perhaps, about my family. We've seen a lot of talent here tonight. We're lucky we'll never see it again. But I'm, for those of you who are away, we have a lot of our family that have come many miles and have young children, and you're not familiar with our family. I'm the 12th child of Otto Rand and Billy Stewart. I have 11 brothers and sisters preceded me, 9 of us of which lived to maturity. As most of you know or have heard during these last couple of days, that we got one sister, Nancy, who died in an automobile accident. But other than that, the 9 of us, 8 of us are living today and are here at this reunion. I was born at the old farm down in Benjamin. I do not know the number of children that were born at the farm. Many of us were born in different areas. Some down there, some in, I think one child was born in Scipio. We had some children born in Ogden. Father and mother moved around considerably in the early years of their marriage. But I was born at the farm where the family was living at the time. World War II, I lived most of my younger life in Salt Lake City, but half the time between Salt Lake and the farm. When World War II came along with my brother Walt, my sister Nancy, I was in the service. And I spent my time in the Air Force. While I was in Texas, I was in the Central Flying Training Command down there. I was stationed at a Goodfellow Field in San Angelo, Texas. There I met Bonnie Jackson, and we became husband and wife while I was in the service in San Angelo, Texas. My wife, stand up, please.
I've never been Jackson.
That's right. Her stepfather is Jackson, and her name is Reed. And I quite frequently say Bonnie Faye Reed Jackson Stewart. That's a lot of name. I just cut it down a little bit. After we got married, just to be tail end of the war in 45, we came back and settled in Salt Lake, and then shortly moved to Provo, where I was in business for a few years. And then we, and I had one... had 2 children born in Provo. Boy, that was a long time ago. We moved to Salt Lake and have lived there ever since. I have 3 children. My oldest son is John. He's married to his... Excuse me. John married Shelley Brimhall, and they have 3 children. John, will you stand up so everybody can see you? Get acquainted a little better with your wife. Then Travis came in between the two boys. Travis also lives in Salt Lake City. Stand up, Travis. Someone who saw some of her handiwork. She manufactures various things. She's a professional seamstress. Then our last son is Lee. He's been MC here tonight. He's married. You and your wife stand up, Lee. They have a small baby that's about 6 and a half months old. A few years ago, we
felt we would like to have something for a little diversification in our life, so we took on a family project of building a cabin down on the Manti Mountains. The Manti is a range of mountains down Highway 89 by Fairview and Mount Pleasant, Manti along in that area. And we have a home down there that we go to and enjoy as much as we possibly can. If any new people from around would like to spend a little time there, let me know, and you're certainly welcome to come. I think Walt's boy went down there for a few days and enjoyed himself. My wife, Bonnie, after the family was gone, felt she would like to do something to become a little more active, and she went to a floral design school. She's been talented in this area for all her life, actually, building nice-looking things with her hands. And after this design school, she got involved in the making of mostly dried flower arrangements, which she has all over the valley. She took this on as a hobby, and it's developed a little beyond a hobby. She has a few nice accounts that show her things around. She has quite a reputation in town as being very proficient in this area. She shows at a few of the trade shows that they have scattered around the valley. She's even thinking of looking at some a little further away than just our immediate valley. Lee and Travis, as many of you know, went on a mission for the church. We had their farewell the same Sunday. Lee went to Georgia, and Travis went to Sweden on their missions. She was gone 6 months shorter than he was. They returned back and have since made lives of their own after their missions. It was quite an experience for the whole family. And having two of your children away, that was two-thirds of our children away at the same time on a mission. It was good for us. It was a very, very good experience for the family. Lee has taken up a trade of a permutator, and John is a builder. He builds homes or whatever may come up in the area of building. They have been so far kept pretty busy, even though we are in this area, we are in a declining market in that area. So we feel we've been very, very fortunate.
Again.
My time is up, and we'll finish. My two little granddaughters are going to sing us a little song, if they can stay awake.
I thought just the girls were.
Three grandchildren.
Yeah, you all ready?
on the occasion of their 60th wedding anniversary. We thought we could do this best by sharing some of the highlights of that marriage with you. Otto and Vivian were married during the Roaring Twenties, a vintage decade. The war to end all wars had just been fought. People could become rich overnight investing in the stock market, and women finally got the vote. Otto and Vivian had two children, Lily and Clark, and were off and running. Vivian had a job in the bank in Spanish Fork, and Otto worked at the Tinney Standard Silver Mines to get enough money to go into beekeeping. Everything would soon be coming up roses. I don't think anybody was ready.
Thank you.
Thank you.
the bank. She retired at age 70, and Otto working in the bees. All of this time, neither one of them have ever thought of divorce. Murder often, but never divorce.